Jonathan Schrager for MixedMartialArts.com in association with Own Bet, and I'm joined today by Spanish heavyweight kickboxer Frank Munoz, who he's actually, just give it a couple of, as an introduction here, Frank, you're the 2013 Super Combat Grand Prix tournament winner, and you're also the current WACO Pro K1 European champion as well. I just wondered, first off, I mean, you've been out there, aka helping Daniel prepare for John Jones, obviously prior to, unfortunately, had to withdraw. The first obvious question is, how did you come onto the radar of Daniel Cormier and AKA and Javier Mendez? How did they become aware of you, and how did they and who drafted you in particularly?
Yeah, right. That's the story. You know, I'm Spanish, but I'm living in Amsterdam, in Holland. It's where I developed my career as a fighter, right?
Yeah.
So, but I'm a very proactive person. I'm also at college, at the University of Amsterdam, studying sports management and business. All right. So actually, I was performing an internship in Chicago in a Muay Thai, a small gym there. So I'm making a business plan and developing the marketing strategies to make growing the business.
Yeah.
All right. So I was there. And that was in February. And at that time, I saw that John Jones was making the preparation and Cormier for their fight. And I just said, all right, Eureka, I'm here. I'm a world-class fighter, striker. Okay, let's talk with that people, with Cormier, you know, because I'm similar physically. You know, my striking is also very similar, like dynamic, unorthodox, like John Jones. So
yeah.
I talked to them, you know, just the head coach, Javier Mendez, you know. I sent him an email, and yeah, after a few days, hey Frank, I didn't know him, huh? So but I know I'm really I good with the communication. So he told me, hey Javier, Frank, we watch your videos, and Daniel Cormier, hey, he really wants you here. So please, how are we gonna do? And nothing, we negotiate, and 2-3 days, I was already flying to California, AKA. And joining the great team of AKA. This is what was it? Very simple. That's how you see.
that's amazing. No, I love it. I mean, as well, the kind of way that we came into contact is obviously through a mutual friend who works in Spanish media as well. So I can tell that's the kind of guy you are. If you want to do something, you go and do it. You go and get it. But do you think it's, well, kind of this story that you're telling us now, is that, does that attest to the fact that if you are a talented person in whatever field and you believe in something, you believe you can go and achieve it, you can go and get it?
Yeah, that's my mentality. It's not like talented. Of course, I'm here not because I look like John Jones. I'm here because I have a CV. I've been fighting around the world 10 years. I fought in the best. I fought in Rico Verhoeven, heavyweight, glory world champion, Nathan Corbett, Australian best of the history. I trained with Peter Ice, Mirko Krokov, Gilbert, many world-class fighters. So that's why they want me. They know I can add my experience, you know, so it's not because I'm just talented, but you need to have also perseverance and faith in yourself and good communication skills and work. You know, I'm a hard worker, you know, and for me, hard work beats talent. That's my mentality. That's who am I, Fran Munoz.
Yeah.
That's how I work. Yeah, so you're right. Sorry.
Yeah, no, fantastic. No, I love that story. I love the fact that you obviously very talented, but like you say, you proactively went to seek that opportunity rather than waiting for someone to come to you and ask you. So I admire that. I think it's a very nice story. I think it's a very nice story. Actually, I haven't set the scene about where you are. You're actually just opposite the MGM Grand, the scene of Saturday night's fight, of course. I know you're there, and we're going to discuss a little bit in a few minutes why you're there this weekend. But firstly, I wanted to ask you, so you contact Javier Mendez, emails you back, reaches out, says, Daniel's seen your videos, we'd love you to come out and help prepare. Just give us an idea of the timeline. How long ago did this email interaction take place? Because we know that, you know, we all know the story that Daniel's had to withdraw from the fight. How long did you actually get to train and prepare with Daniel?
Oh, I've been there. The story was very quick because that was about about 20, 22 of March. All right. I contacted them. So 23, no, okay, no, no, 20, 21 of March, I was already there. So 4 days before that, you know, so 15, 16 March, I was already speaking with them. And I've been there like 20, 25 days. I was there in the AKA. And just the last day I was flying back, it was when he got injured, unfortunately.
Oh.
And it was even with me, you know. So it was a freaking accident, you know, that shit happens, sorry, sometimes. And it was not even hard, but just, you know, an accident, shin against shin,
yeah.
And boom.
Yeah,
bad luck.
But clearly you did have, so you think you had maybe in the region of 3 to 4 weeks of helping Daniel prepare prior to the injury.
Yeah, 4 weeks. Four weeks.
And I suppose, well, the first question is just regarding Daniel as a person. And anyone who knows Daniel and you ask them about him are very complimentary. They all say he's a great guy. What were your impressions of training with him? Obviously, he's brought you in to help him prepare. Did you have the great experience of training alongside him for that month?
Well, I need to say, AKA, not only Daniel Cormier, Javier Mendez, of course, Crazy Bob, Joanna, the mastermind after the AKA, everybody welcomed me, you know, treated me very warm, you know. I was feeling at home since the first day. And of course, Daniel Cormier, he was really thankful to me to be there helping him out. He's big, but he has even a bigger heart, you know, really, really warm, really, really, really awesome, awesome personality, you know.
Yeah, and
amazing.
And during that 4 weeks that you spent with him, from a technical standpoint,
of course, I really enjoy, and not only with him, because then I also had the opportunity to work with Cain Velasquez and Luke Rockhall and Khabib Nurmagomedov. So all the great guys they have there. So we improve each other. So I add my experience, my stand-up, but they also, they show me. I learn from them with the wrestling and jiu-jitsu, you know. So I knew in that game, in the ground. So also for me, I evolve as a fighter. So I'm very thankful also to them.
But just relating to Daniel specifically, we you know, we all know, the general consensus is that the first fight was quite a unanimous victory for John Jones, and people, you know, skeptics, people were speculating that it would be difficult for Daniel to overturn that defeat. From that 4 weeks that you spent with Daniel, were you able, what specifically were you able to help him improve upon? To obviously ensure that he will be able to win in the rematch.
Well, I cannot tell you specifically what we were working, as you know.
Yeah.
But you know, hey, I wasn't here 1 year ago when they fought John Jones against Cormier first time. But in words of Javier Mendez, he's a head coach, we watched thousands of times the first fight together, no, to making the strategy, the gaming plan, He was completely a new fighter, Cormier, much more complete, you know. So his condition, awesome, amazing, you know. We were sparring 3, 5, 6, 7 rounds in a row. He was like nothing. So he was in a beast mode, Daniel Cormier. And we watched the fight, and I saw it. And until the first 3 rounds, the fight was 50-50, was even, all right. The last 2 rounds, Cormier slowed down. He gets out a little bit, and then it was when John Jones really won clearly the last 2 rounds. But until the third round, it was okay, the fight. So now, with another game plan, with a better conditioning, I'm sure he will beat John Jones, you know? I don't say easy, but he will beat that big time, that time.
And was he doing, you mentioned it there, you know, 3, 5, 6, 7 rounds sparring. Was he doing that specifically with yourself? I know AKA's renowned.
I was one more of them. So we were changing, you know, 3
changing
with me,
up, yeah.
2 with another one, with everybody, you know, but with fresh people. So that's why his condition is amazing, you know. I had, between rounds, I could rest, but he not. And then I was again with him. So, you know, putting the pressure. So that's why I know what I'm talking.
And what... with specific relation to yourself, I mean, you kind of referenced it before. It made sense to isolate and to pinpoint yourself as someone they were going to draft in as a partner for DC, because your dimensions, your frame is very similar to that of a John Jones. You know, you've got a long reach, long limbs.
Yeah.
You're a big guy. How was he faring against yourself? Because obviously the best barometer of how he's going to compete against John Jones is if he's fighting someone who can replicate that style and who has a similar frame, and you kind of match that bill perfectly. How was he faring against you in those preparations?
He was a spectacular, you know, putting the pressure on me, because there is no secret, you know, he needs to fight against John Jones. You cannot wait. So so he was doing that with me, and you know, he during the 2, 3 rounds, 4, 5 that he's not only with me, with all the fighters, his tempo of fighting was amazing, you know. So that's why I'm also very, very, very sorry, very pissed off that he cannot fight. He's not able to show to the world that he was ready this time, you know. We made a great synergy, you know, with me, with Leandro Vieira, jiu-jitsu trainer, you know, the boxing trainers, Cruz, and Rosendo, you know, with the head coach of Javier Mendez. We had really an awesome atmosphere, and we were all united for this objective to beat that John Jones. So, too bad.
And it sounds like a pretty obvious question, and I'm guessing if it doesn't interrupt your studies, that you're going to be there. Presumably he's going to draft you in again when this rematch does transpire, when he has to initiate the next training camp. Presumably he wants you there.
Yeah, that's the thing, you know, because now I was able to do it because I have 4 months off from the university. Yeah. But now in 2 weeks, I need to go back Amsterdam.
Right.
So we still don't know where they're going to fight. You know, if they fight in November, I would not be able to come here 1 month or 2 months, because I need to go physically to the classes in Amsterdam. So yeah. that's the downside of the story, you know. So I'm really sorry. But if he fight in 2017, you know, February, or November, March, April, you know, in 1 year, because you never know. With John Jones, always do crazy stuff. So I'm not sure that they're going to fight in New York or in July to UFC 200. So we'll see. If it's next year, I'm going to be back here in America. Okay? So I will be able already to join forces. We'll see.
And what about you? Say, for example, in the event that there's a quick turnaround, you know, people are speculating maybe if John Jones wins comfortably on Saturday and he emerges unscathed, uninjured, that maybe they could even get the fight on at UFC 200. Would you be able to help him prepare if the fight's in July?
Yeah, that's why. I have classes until July. You know, I have exams until the end of June, you know, so I'm not gonna be able.
Well, from the sounds of things, it sounds like obviously that Daniel will be disappointed, because you've been a great help for him. I was going to say, not just from the technical standpoint, from the psychological standpoint of the fight, I imagine you got to spend some time with Daniel, you know, chatting with him outside of training, maybe socializing a little bit, going for meals.
Yeah.
It was quite clear, it was visibly clear that when the fight was still on, and they did the press conference, that Daniel was riled by the fact that people were booing him, cheering John Jones, you know, given the scenario. He seemed like he was very emotional about that fact. What was his mindset like going into that fight?
Let's be honest. They don't like each other, you know. I cannot say he hates him, but Daniel don't like the John Jones. This is obvious. So this preparation, you know, we also work in this mental welfare. So he was actually really quiet, you know. Yeah. He just was focused on training, you know, do his things, and then we're going to make our game plan and show it to the world who is the best. And the best, in my eyes and of the team, is Daniel Cormier, you know. That's what was no bullshit.
And are you able to give us an insight into, because as we know in combat sports, especially the media, they focus a lot on the physical preparation. Maybe the mental side of the game sometimes can be overlooked. When you say he was preparing mentally as well, what kind of things are we talking about here? Can you give us any insight into that?
Well, preparing is difficult to explain, because every person that is different, but I saw him from the, because I spent many, many hours. We talked about life, about everything. And the good things about Daniel Cormier, I see with him that he's very smart. He listened everybody around the team, He was asking me advice. He was then to the jiu-jitsu coach Leandro, the boxer. Hey, he listened everybody, and then he made his conclusions, and then he take the best options according to him. But he's very open-minded to new ways of training, a little bit, a little some small tips. He always is very respectful and listen to people. So he was just, focus on working, improving, listen everybody around, take from something from me, something from there, something from that. So his mindset was that, looks learning like a sponge, absorbing information, for beating John Jones. That's
Yeah.
what I can say about the mental state.
Yeah, for sure. And just a question as well. We all know that, it's well documented Daniel's history in terms of being a very highly credentialed wrestler, an Olympian wrestler. As yourself as an elite stand-up fighter, an elite kickboxer, when you train with guys that obviously come from a different background, a different discipline, I wanted to ask your opinion on Daniel and his evolution as a stand-up fighter. As an elite kickboxer yourself, do you think Daniel could compete in pure kickboxing? Is he that good?
Right. If he trained, he could. He could. Because I didn't know his story, but he told me that before his debut in Strikeforce, he never fought boxing or kickboxing. And I said, come on, man. How you did that? He said, nothing. After 6 months, I came here to train Caín Velázquez Luz Rojo. I was all my life wrestling, a wrestler. And then, my first fight won by knockout, then the second, the third. And in 3 years, he was already in the UFC. I said, wow, this guy is amazing, I don't know, I don't know, the gift. I've been 10 years fighting around the world to reach a world-class level. And he's doing it in just 3 years. So he's amazing. He's amazing.
And then I suppose the obvious question with yourself, like you kind of referenced it there before, that it was almost an exchange of knowledge. You were able to impart your knowledge with the stand up and vice versa. They would impart knowledge with wrestling, jiu-jitsu. It sounds from the way you're talking that you are interested in, certainly interested in learning other martial arts. We know you're an elite kickboxer. You're a world-class kickboxer. Have you got any interest in transitioning across to MMA?
Well, that's a very good question that you asked me. Now that I discovered, how this is the MMA, how they train here, I felt in love, So I'm a fighter, so I want to be a complete fighter. And next year, if I come back here to the States, definitely, certainly maybe I'm going to join AKA, I don't know, sure, but I'm gonna start training, full-time wrestling, jiu-jitsu, MMA, and in the future, I don't know, 6 months, 1 year, I want to fight. I want to fight MMA. I know I can do
And
it.
is this something that literally has just developed since you went to AKA and you spent the time? Because obviously we know you were in, like you mentioned before, you were in a gym in Chicago. I believe you were just focusing on kickboxing still. Is this something that's developed literally for you in the last few months?
That wasn't. No, I was. As a fan, I like MMA. I like UFC. And I follow that. And I was since 3, 4 years ago. I'm interested, but in Amsterdam, I don't have the opportunity to train MMA regularly. So now I really test myself against the best in the world, and I see I have the physically. I have the not the talent, but I'm good absorbing, learning new things, and I am enjoying. The wrestling, the jiu-jitsu, I like it. So I say, come on, if Javier Mendez told me you train with us here in 6 months, 1 year, you're ready to go. You're ready to go. So, okay, I believe him. I believe myself too. So, I will
Yeah.
do
Fantastic. Yeah, I've got a feeling, Frank, that maybe in a year or two's time we'll be seeing you
Yes.
compete high level MMA. I've just got a feeling. Just a couple more, and appreciate the time. I was going to ask you mentioned before about the other elite fighters at AK that you're able to spend time with, training and what have you, the likes of Kane and Luke Rockhold and Habib, just in terms of specifically what you took away from those experiences as well about training with those individual fighters, because each have their own amazing skill set.
Yeah, awesome. From every one of them, I took some small things, you know. Caín Velázquez is very, we have good relation because he speaks Spanish with me. You know, he has a Mexican, past. So he was very happy to can practice Spanish. He was, hey, Frank, how, como estás? How are you? Always very, very, very friendly with me. And he was giving me tips with the boxing. He's very good at striking, you know, also. So we spar a lot, you know, with technique. And I learned a lot from him about you know, more precision, you know, the very good tips. And then, for example, for Luke Rockhold, amazing, this guy, the timing and the footwork that he has. Is awesome, you know. So I also learned from him, you know, and try to change some techniques. But you know, his ground game is also from another level. I didn't expect that, but he's amazing. Huh? I don't know which belt is him in jiu-jitsu, but he looks like black for sure. I don't know. And of course, and Khabib, he's a smaller. I didn't spar too much with him because I'm too big for him. But I'm very cool guy. We went out for dinner and eating, and he's always like joking, you know. It's the happiness of the gym. Him and Daniel Cormier, of course, because these two guys are always, you know, picking each other and making jokes. So amazing team, amazing team.
Wow, it's amazing. And by the way you're talking, obviously you're an elite stand-up fighter, but by the way you're talking, if you've got this intrigue about the other martial arts and you go to AKA and you train alongside the elite fighters in their category, it sounds like it only might be a matter of time before we may be seeing you compete at a good level as well. So I'm excited personally to see if you develop and you manage, you pursue mixed martial arts. I'm fascinated to see that. One more question I wanted to ask you about your well, I suppose your time there in Vegas. I kind of mentioned it before. We've got the MGM in the background. People might not be able to see it because the sun and what have you in the car, but the MGM is there in the background.
Yeah,
You
who's behind?
exactly. You booked your flight for this week specifically in anticipation of Daniel being there to fight John.
About my time here in Vegas, I didn't mention, but it was not only vacations, you know. I've been also training here, you know, with the last past days, you know, with Uriah Faber, you know, he's fighting against Anderson Silva, Extreme Couture. Very, very great team there, you know, thanks to Eric and Robert, the two managers and head coaches from there. They welcomed me there. So I also have the opportunity to spar with them, and they have some amazing team here in Vegas. I'm in love. I will stay here already also, you know, in America, USA, not only here in Vegas, in California. I love. This is my place. I discovered, you know,
It
as a
is.
fighter.
Did you say Uriah there? As in Uriah Hall? You've been working with
Yeah,
him?
Ryan Hall, Ryan Hall. Sorry for my pronunciation. Ryan
No.
Hall.
No, I thought that's what you mentioned. So you've
Ryan
been
Hall.
that's fascinating. So you've been doing
Yeah.
some work with Uriah this week ahead of his fight with
Yeah.
Anderson. That's
Yeah. He's
amazing.
amazing.
Did did the, did 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 they again, did they seek you out for that opportunity? Did they specifically want you to do some work with Uriah because of your
That's why, because I was there yesterday. He was not there, but I was here 2 days ago. The first day was not there, but yesterday he was there. And of course, his trainer is Lamer, okay. So, but they are there in the Extreme Couture because they have more fighters. They live in a small town, 2 hours from Las Vegas, okay. So he's traveling here, and now he's gonna stay. The training camp is gonna be here. So yesterday, very friendly, you know, he's treating me like one of them. His coach, helping me out. He said, "Hey, let's spar." I explained my story. I'm a kickboxer, stand up there. Let's spar together. And we did almost 5 rounds together there, working on the speed and techniques. Amazing. But very, very pleased to try to be able to help him. He told me, like, "Frank Munoz, hey, too bad that you leave in Sunday, man. You should stay here for my training camp." Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Sorry.
So,
I need to leave.
yeah. So that's very good. So he's looking. Uriah's looking good then ahead of the fight, because as we know, he's a very dynamic striker as well. Well, they're both dynamic strikers.
Yeah.
Him and Anderson.
Yeah, it's gonna be an amazing fight. But I was surprised. He's very heavy. He's like me now. He's like 210, 212 pounds, and it's amazing the weight cut he's doing. I would not be able to do it. This is another one of the things I'm learning. If I fight, maybe I'm not going to be any more light heavyweight. I need to go middleweight, but we see.
Okay, yeah.
They are big like me, these guys. It's amazing.
And what's the sense? I mean, I know you're staying just opposite the MGM. You're staying near the Strip. What's the sense of the buzz around this event? I don't know, maybe not as of yet, your recognizable face in the US, because obviously you're well known in Europe for kickboxing. You may not be as recognizable to the US combat sports fans at this stage, but what's the buzz been like? I mean, I saw you posted a picture, you've been at the open workouts where John Jones was. What's the buzz? Are people generally excited for this fight against Ovince St. Preux, or are they talking about the disappointment that it's not DC this weekend?
Drew, I was between the around between the fans in the opening workouts, and they were making like, "Hey, are you John Jones?" So they start and they say, then they some reporters they told me that I was one of the official sparring partners of Daniel Cormier and made me some small interviews. So people getting to know me already.
Yeah.
But being through the atmosphere for me is a bit down. It's not as hype as if Cormier will be fighting here, because now for me the main event, even than John Jones against Sam Pros, is Cejudo against Johnson. This fight is going to be amazing. I saw these guys working out. Wow, what a speed, what a technique. This is going to be the for me the main event is that, right now.
Yeah.
And for the fans too, I'm more excited for that. Ovince is not a he's not still a superstar. So he's a very cool guy. I saw him, He's very quiet, but he's not superstar yet. So what we can do?
and did I saw you took that, you had the picture with John. Is he aware that you were one of the men plotting his downfall? Did he know that you're Daniel's sparring partner?
I spoke with him. I spoke with you. Hey, I make a joke. I say, "Hey, what? How? You look like me, man." And he was surprised. He said, "What the fuck are you talking?" I know. And nothing. We take him on a picture. Yeah, he's okay. He's okay. He's fine. I don't tell. I don't tell. I don't tell him. But he will figure it out when they fight.
He'll recognize you again from that picture. Right. He'll say, "I recognize you." No, because I wondered. It was funny. I saw that picture and I wondered if he knew that you were one of the men plotting his downfall. Well, the last question I have for you, and it's something that you've mentioned a little bit before during this interview, your studies, juggling being an elite athlete with doing a course. I believe you're studying sports management at Amsterdam University. How do you find that? From what you were telling me before, does the course finish at the end of this year? This is your last year, and then you'll be able to focus mainly on your combat sports for the next couple of years?
All right. This is a bachelor studies, a degree. It's 4 years. I'm now in my third. So I did 3 years, so I have 1 year more. But the last year, you can go abroad. So you can go 6, 7 months, any part of the world to make getting experience in the real world. So that's why next year I'm planning to come here to the States and working, some big agencies, some gyms. We see now I'm making growing my network here, because I know the sport as an athlete, and now I have the education, the knowledge. I have the my personality, with the communication and marketing myself. I'm good with that, so I can be a good sports manager. Sorry to talk like that, but I know.
No, no, I agree, Frank. I understand exactly what you're saying, and of course, you're slowly building your network impressively as well. You know, you're meeting high profile people, so of course, it's very clear that you're going to be successful whatever you do, sport, business, whatever. So it's very very good. I wish you the best with it, of course, and obviously appreciate the time today. Have a great time this weekend. Enjoy the fights. And hopefully
Thank you.
we'll hopefully we'll get you on again at some point in the near future to discuss yourself or people you're training alongside, whatever. We'll keep in touch.
Yeah, definitely. Thank you very much, Jonathan, for this interview. It has been a pleasure to talk with you. Also a high profile reporter, as you are, one of the best. Leaking the news about McGregor, that you was one of the first talking with something some familiar related to him, and everybody was retweeting. So good source always
Oh,
for
thank you,
you.
Frank. I appreciate that. No, I did the yeah. We did okay on the McGregor front the last couple of days, but no, I really appreciate that. But it's been an absolute pleasure chatting with you, and we'll obviously get you on again when you've got some news yourself. But I wish you the best with your studies as well, and an
Well,
absolute pleasure.
a pleasure. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Frank,
All
and
right.
enjoy Vegas.
Thank you. Oosh.
See you later. Bye bye.
See you. Bye. Oh.